What's up, everybody? Danny Boy here from Wave 89.1 Manila, Mix Radio on Dash Radio, and Mix Global on YouTube, Twitch, and Kumu. And with me right now is the man, the legend, Russ. What's up, bro?
What's going on? Appreciate the intro.
Yeah, man, for sure. And, you know, I appreciate you. We talked a little bit off air, and, you know, we're so happy to have you. The Philippines is excited. We did announce that we'll be doing an interview with you soon.
Yeah.
So a lot of people have been reacting, so I got some fan questions and stuff lined up for you.
All right? Let's do it.
All right. But before we get there, how's everything going, man? How's this new normal of social distancing, like, treating you?
It's good. It seems like Atlanta, everything is kind of back to normal, even if it quote unquote shouldn't be. But I don't know. I've enjoyed my time at home. Hold on. Give me 1 second. Can I close my doors?
Because
my fucking
sure.
dogs are going to
take It's all me. Good.
And make it a little bit brighter. let me just get us right. Sorry, my puppy's a fucking monster.
You're all good. How many puppies you got?
My puppy's a maniac.
How many puppies do you have?
Well, I have one, but she's a fucking handful.
I see. Oh, yeah, that one you posted. She's cute. Chloe, right?
Yes, Chloe.
There we go. Yeah. All right. Yeah. Well, you're known to be like a workaholic. And other than not being able to perform or like be with huge crowds, is anything really different in terms of your workload and how you you work on your craft? I would imagine it's the same, right?
Yeah, it's the same. I mean, I'm sitting in the studio right now. It's in my basement. So it's nothing's changed as far as workflow. In fact, I'm making more stuff just because I get to be home. So I'm making more. It's like I've enjoyed it, to be honest.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, we're going to talk about the new track with Kehlani, Take You Back, in a bit. But allow me to kind of pick your brain and ask you those fan questions and like some just random stuff. No relation. It's just random. All right, here we go.
Also, for everyone that's going to watch this, I just got out of the shower. That's why my face is red.
It's all good, man. Well, last year, I got to sit down and chat with you briefly before your show here in Manila. What was your memory of the Philippines that you can take away that you still remember?
It lived up to the hype, for sure. Yeah, because I remember going into it like, I'm curious to see how crazy this show is, just because like the online response was just is like always been nuts from the Philippines. So it was dope to be like, oh, all right, y'all are like insane, you know?
And, yeah, yeah. And I remember you talking about jumping in the pool.
Yes, with Bozzy.
Right, with Bozzy, and like you lost your shoes or you gave them away or something. Something like that.
I think I threw my shoes and I lost one of my rings.
Oh man,
I remember correctly.
You seem like a really cool guy to party with too. So that must have been like awesome just being
there. I feel like I'm a good time.
All right. So everybody watching right now, we have a little clip of Bozzy and Russ together on stage during his surprise, I guess you can say cameo during a show. Check this out. So speaking of your tour, when everything goes back to normal, I'm sure Manila's got to be a spot you return to, right?
Hell yeah.
Definitely. And I saw that you posted a schedule for next year during your North America tour, or is it just a U.S. tour?
Yeah, that was just North America.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, but like, man, 2020, it was going to be so crazy because I was going like everywhere, like Nigeria, Kenya, India, Philippines, Malaysia, you know what I'm saying? Just like everywhere. And Brazil, Argentina, Peru. Like I was about to be gone from May until December.
Wow.
Yeah, with like a couple weeks home, maybe.
That's crazy. That's crazy. Yeah. And any new spots that you haven't been to yet that you were supposed to go to during this?
Nigeria was like Nigeria, India, Kenya. Was it Kenya or was it Ghana? Maybe it was all three of those, but yeah, I haven't been to Argentina. I haven't been to Chile. I haven't been to a couple places I was going to go to for the first time. And man, get this, you know, can I curse or no? This is radio. I can't.
Yeah, no, you're good. You're good.
I'm so fucking burnt about what happened because so my birthday is September 26th, right?
What?
So I was going to be on my birthday. No one knows this yet, but get how fucking insane this is going to be. Oh, September 25th, I was going to be doing a show in Egypt at the pyramids.
What?
Meaning I would have been on stage when it struck midnight, my birthday, and I would be performing in front of the fucking pyramids. Are you kidding?
Oh my God. That's like, crazy.
I'm gonna try to schedule it for next year at the same time because that's just the sickest birthday I can.
That would be amazing, bro. And my birthday is on the 25th of September.
That's no shit.
Crazy. Yeah. Gang. Libra. Shit. That's what's up. All right. Well, after your show last year, during your show last year in Manila, it seemed like everybody knew every word to every song. Yeah. And you had a huge crowd reaction. I even saw that you got a little emotional, bro, during it was one of your songs.
Probably
that
nobody knows.
Nobody knows. What brought that out of you, man? Those emotions. And like,
that's an emotional ass song. That was like, that song was made during such a low point mentally for me. And it's like, I don't know, performing it sometimes I'm not going to lie. There's sometimes where I'm not fully emotionally connected to the song the same way I was when I wrote it, obviously. But sometimes on stage I have those moments where I'm like, damn, you know, where you like you go right back to that place.
Especially when the whole crowd singing it along word for word with you.
Yeah, like that. When they started singing it, I remember like because I did it a cappella. After the song ended, I did it a cappella and then they just took over and I was like, this is crazy.
Goosebumps, bro. I got goosebumps. Yeah. And speaking of that, let's show the people right now that are watching and tuning in a little clip of that performance. Check this out. Go insane, go, go. My pain, hold back my tears. I'm going insane. Nobody knows. All by myself. Let the rain hit me. I'm going insane. Nobody knows. Inside and outside heavy. I might call it eggs, chicken, drink some honey. Starting on my day with some shit already. Answering the phone like I'm pissed already. Media is lying, getting used to it. Crucifying me, I need a crucifix. Guess I looked apart, so I might as well. Heaven's where you get when you fight through hell. People keep slandering, but I can't respond because if I do, I'll call me crazy. Focus is wrong, I'm feeling fed up, yeah. This isn't natural. Keep it together, man. Fall apart of music. I can't let them see the pain when I'm the one that goes through it. It's some real life shit. Sometimes I feel like shit. Mask up my pain. Hold back my tears. I'm going insane. All by myself, let the rain hit me. Go insane, nobody knows. Listen, make some noise for yourselves right now, Philippines. That's the greatest I've ever heard that song. Make some motherfucking noise for yourselves. All right, so when you have a new song that's out, I know you're probably super like anxious to like go out and perform in front of a crowd, but with the current circumstances, of course, that's not possible right now. And do you ever think about doing maybe a live streaming concert?
No.
Really? Why not? You're not into that kind of stuff?
I get. Here's the thing. Don't let these artists fool you. They're doing it for money. These artists are going broke right now. They're not on some like, I just want to, you know, I still just want to be there for my fans. Shut up. You're going broke. You're going broke because y'all don't own your music. Y'all are making 90% of your income was coming from touring, which is now stopped. You're going broke and you need the money. You're not like, shut up. You're not this like amazing. I'm just trying to give back to the fans, man. I'm just really, nah.
Yeah.
Like at the end of the day, concerts are not meant to be that. You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to spoil. I'm not even going to do that to my fans. I'm not going to do that to myself. That's not even what I worked hard for. I didn't work hard to perform in a room by myself. Like,
right,
it's not
right.
happening. I don't care how much money y'all throw at me. I don't need the money. I want to do things the right way. And that's the beautiful thing of financial freedom is when you don't need the money, you don't make decisions based off of I need the money.
Right, right.
Let me ask you this question. How many artists do you think would be doing live shows if they didn't need the money?
Oh, very little.
Come on. All right. So that's my point.
Yeah. Very true.
I think it's like I've like logged on and watched one of them before for 20 seconds. I was like, this is the dumbest shit I've ever seen.
Well, to be honest, it depends on the artist too, I guess.
Right? Nah, but still, I'm just like.
I get you, though.
I'm like, what are we doing? Like, who gives a fuck?
I get you, man. That's funny. You're the type of artist that interacts with fans online anyways. You know what I mean? Just naturally.
Yeah, it's like.
On your own.
Yeah, I don't know. I guess I can never say never, but that shit just I'm not into it personally. If you're into it, I get it, that's cool, but I just
basically bottom line, you don't need the money like that, you're cool.
Yeah, that's I'm cool. I want to do things the right way. I'll see y'all when I see y'all, and it'll be that much sweeter. You know what I mean?
Exactly. Leave a little like I guess waiting time for people to be more anxious.
Yeah.
To see you. Yeah. I get that for sure. Now back when you put out a song a week on SoundCloud for like 2 years straight, or maybe even more, which was freaking amazing, bro. Like that's how I learned about you back in those days. And, you know, that was the platform back then, SoundCloud.
It was. I caught it right in that sweet spot.
You did. Perfect timing. And now it's TikTok. So what are your feelings on TikTok?
I have a lot of feelings on TikTok. And good I'll get
bad.
Into them.
Or bad.
So I think, for starters, TikTok is dope because it provided another revenue stream for people in general. Like you see these people that I didn't know about before, you know, that are making 70K a post or whatever the hell it is, which is cool. It's like you like anyone who makes an app that provides another revenue stream for people is sick. And then on top of that, it's helped artists blow up, which is also awesome. The problem is that I think we're entering and we're in a time where you're going to see the most one hit wonders of all time.
Yes.
Because what TikTok is doing, it's making songs big. It's not making artists big. Like it's the definition of we know your song. We don't know who the fuck you are. Like a lot of these artists who blow up on TikTok, if you bumped into them on the street, you wouldn't even know who they are because all you know is 15 seconds of just the hit part of the song. And a lot of times it's the hook, right? It's the hook that's catchy, and it's which is not even the main artist part. It's like a sample on the hook, or it's the beat, or it's the this. You know what I mean? It's like, man. And then what's happening, right? These artists are going viral on TikTok off of 15 seconds, not even a full song, not a full out for 15 seconds. A label swoops in, throws $1 million at them just so that they can own the song forever. They have no intention of keeping these artists because they're not long-term career artists. They're just, here's $1 million. Give me your song forever. I'll tell you that we're doing an album deal. We have no interest. We'll drop you in a year. And these artists go back to the fucking drawing board after a year of getting dropped from the label. And it's like, you don't even own the hit song that blew you up. It's like, it's a crazy thing. You're about to see so many one-hit wonder, depressed, miserable stories. But it's cool if you know how to utilize it. I've utilized TikTok campaigns. Sometimes they work, sometimes they don't. That's the funny thing about TikTok is like what they want went dumb viral on TikTok randomly recently for no reason. Like I spent money on it just randomly. Same with Psycho Part 2. And then the flip side of it is I've spent money at TikTok on songs and it didn't do anything. So it's like, I kind of like that though. I like that, you know what? You can't just spend money and it work. It's like, if it's going to work, it's going to work. If it doesn't, it doesn't. So,
yeah. Because I've even seen people do stuff for like recently.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah, so that's a campaign that I just started.
Oh, okay. Okay.
We'll see if it works.
Yeah. I've seen some clips because, you know, just random, you know, my job is to always research. And I've seen some pop up with some, you know.
Well, good for me.
Cool dancing. Yeah.
Good I'm for proud you. Of y'all TikTok. Thank you. Wow. I just came from Crucial, I threw 40, then said adios. Bye. I may not be perfect, but shit, I'm probably close. I'm off the coast, my fragrance.
With social media being such a huge tool for music, one downside, of course, you talk about this all the time, like everyone's a critic, everyone's a tough guy. Mr. Know-it-alls are out there. Yeah. And I know we're all human, so it's got to affect certain artists like you. Like, I'm sure, like, most of the time you can just brush it aside and whatever. But does it ever affect you? And, like, how do you handle that type of...
No, people talking shit about my music has never affected me, despite what people think. It's people lying. That's the, like, annoying thing. Yeah. People lying, making up stories about me will affect anyone. I don't care who you are.
Right.
If there's a story out there about you that's not true and it's public, you're obviously going to be like, this is some bullshit. I don't care who you are. Right. Like, but people talking shit about my music, no. But then the other thing that is just like dumb to me and unnecessary is when people with a platform who don't know me at all choose to use their platform to mobilize negativity in my direction. Mm-hmm. It's like, at the end of the day, bro, you're doing what I'm doing in the sense that you're trying to make something out of nothing, build your platform, build your audience, and make a living off of it. So why are you, you know, the effects of like someone using their platform to just like send a narrative and negativity your way. Why? Like, I take that shit as offensive as it is, because it's one thing for Joe Schmo in Nebraska to be like, fuck Russ, whatever. But if you have a platform and you're using your platform and, you know, whoever you are, your fans listen to you. So if you're using your platform and mobilizing your audience to have a certain perspective of me, I'm going to take it as war, because that's what you're doing. You're taking your army of people and sending them my way. So that's like, I don't feel bad for people who you know, have to deal with the consequences of that at all. I don't know y'all anyway. People get beat up every day anyway. So
it's who cares? Yeah, man. And also, it's so cool how we can see behind the scenes with artists like you. You know, back in the day when I was growing up, I'm older, so I didn't know much about my favorite artists growing up, except just their music or when they had interviews, right? And now we get to see, you know, everything. Like, if you decide to post a story or whatever the case. And can you imagine, like, people, like, let's just say, like, Jordan during this era? Like,
I know. I don't know how I flip-flop on how. How do you feel about that?
I don't know. I just feel like there's less mystery, right?
Way less mystery.
Right. So because sometimes, or for me growing up, a lot of times the mystery is what made me want to buy their record or made me want to watch their movie. On the flip side, there was times like, I wish I knew more about Denzel. I wish I knew more about Pac, other than.
Well, because we're nosy by nature.
True. So this is like the good time for nosy people to be in your business. And and like the whole social media thing about putting your music out there is definitely it's a good time for artists right now. The thing I have a problem with is, you know, artists that aren't like you, that don't put out quality and they get big and they keep putting out garbage and they have a market for it because they can easily just put something up on Spotify or whatever.
Sure.
So quality over quantity is kind of not a thing anymore.
No, although I don't think it should be, because it doesn't, because I'll tell you why. No one cares. Like, if you're trying to get on and you can't put out, Let me rephrase this. You can't put out trash, right? Yeah. But if you're putting out good songs, but they're not hits, no one cares that, like, oh, bro, like, that song didn't connect. That one, no one cares, because the reality is this. The only people who hear your songs that aren't hits are your fans. And your fans love when you give them music. They don't give a fuck what's going on, as long as it's not fucking terrible.
Yeah.
But they don't care what you get. Like, what? Give me music. I'm a fan. Now, the people on the outside who aren't your fans, they're only going to hear your shit. It's only going to make it to them if it's a hit. You know what I'm saying? Like, so it doesn't matter. Like, when I was flooding on SoundCloud, even I was just flooding. I'm flooding this year.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter about, like, what songs, like, okay, Take You Back is going crazy, right? And I'm about to drop the video, taking it to radio, doing the whole shit. You think anyone in the world cares about the other 9 songs I put out? No.
It makes sense.
No one's like, yeah. Like, look at Best on Earth. Best on Earth was I dropped a song every week for 6 weeks. Best on Earth was the 6th one. Do you think anyone in the world was like, it's a hit, but, like, I can't let this slide with those other 5 songs you dropped. No one gives a fuck. Artists get in their own way with that shit. They're too narcissistic and, like, ego-driven, where they're like, nah, like if I put out this song, it doesn't do well. Like, I'm going to look crazy. Like, no, bro, you're going to look crazy if you try and fucking hold back everything and attach results to every little – it's like, relax. Just let the shit fly.
I love how you always in your interviews always drop jewels and gems and
I try advice.
Yeah. I like that, man. I think that's the thing I like most about you. Of course, your music is always dope, and I've been telling you that. But like, I feel like it's your calling to give advice and have a responsibility to those who care to listen to you. Like,
I do, because at the end of the day, it's like I have a platform, and I feel like I'm occupying this space for a given period of time where people give a fuck what I'm talking about. And while I'm here and occupying that space, I should use it, you know, responsibly. So I think, you know, my whole thing is no one has to listen to me. My way is not the only way, mm-hmm. but it's like, I just feel like people should at least appreciate that I'm trying to provide an alternate route for you to go. You don't have to do it my way, but you're broke and you haven't figured it out yet. Maybe you should try my way.
Yeah. And you even wrote a book. It's all in your head. Man, when that came out, were you a little nervous excitement? Because, you know, you're a musician. People don't know you as a writer, but did you have any nervous excitement about that?
No, I wasn't nervous at all. Because I think, like, once again, I knew that it was instantly going to my fans. You know what I'm saying? And I knew my fans were going to love it because I've already been giving that type of information in my music. So I knew they were going to love it. Like, I was so confident in that book because I've had that idea for several years. So, like, it was just one of those ideas that I knew. I was like, nah, this is out of here. This is just crazy idea. It's on your head. The chapters are going to be song titles. Artworks are going to be the pages. Like, I just knew. I knew that was out of here, you know?
Yeah, man. Yeah, man. And I like how you use, like, I guess you can say your own type of emojis for your album art or your single art.
Yeah. That's the little icons.
Little icons. I like that. Well, let's talk about the album Shake the Snow Globe, the deluxe edition. It was released a few months back, the deluxe, and it had a handful of tracks from there that affected or was on Manila radio. All right, so there was three that I can remember right now: 3 a.m. with Ty Dolla $ign, Guess What with Rick Ross, and Best on Earth with Vida. Yeah. I remember you even said it just a little bit earlier that you tweeted something like, "Hey, look at this. This is my the last song I posted from this project, and this is the one that made it to Billboard." And you were even saying like, "Yo, don't doubt yourself. Just keep making music and putting it out there." Right. So just another piece of advice that you gave. Why did you not expect anything from Best on Earth? Is it because it sounds kind of different from what you're used to doing? Or what was it? What was it about that song that kind of gave you low expectations and then having it actually be really successful?
I don't know. I don't know. I think because I'm trying to think back now.
Yeah, I just remember a tweet. You're like, "Yo,
I know, and I'm trying to even figure out myself why I didn't. I thought it was. I think everything I do is good, right? So let's say I think everything I do is good. I didn't think it was like incredible, you know. I thought it was good. Like I think All to You is a better song, mm-hmm. like a song like that. But I see why Best on now that it worked. I see why it worked, but I think also just because the night we did it so fast. But see, I'm talking all this shit. What the fuck am I talking about? Because there's also a fucking clip of me in the studio talking about I was going platinum. So what am I talking about? I don't know what I'm talking about.
Yeah,
I guess but I think every song I do is going to go platinum. So I don't I wasn't that crazy about it because I made it and it was one of those I'm faded in the studio. Yeah. So I'm just lit on the song. I think it's incredible when I'm doing it. Obviously, I wasn't making it being like, this is okay. I'm like, this is incredible. This is hard.
Yeah.
But then, you know, you wake up and you make some more shit. And it wasn't that I guess it's less that I didn't think that it wasn't incredible. It's that I made it February 2019. And by mm-hmm. the time it came to like start putting together the album, it just got lost in the pile because I was just over it. Because as an artist, like my favorite shit is always my newest shit. So
right. Right.
It was just one of those ones that was like old and I didn't think much of it.
I see. So pleasantly surprised, basically.
I wasn't, put it like this. What it was, it's not that I didn't think it was incredible. It's incredible. What it was is that I wasn't excited about it as much. And people don't, well, I think I've said this before. The verse I put on it in the studio that night is not the verse that's on there. That was the other reason. Cause I was like, not the original verse I laid on it was cool, but it was just like, if you hear it compared to what I ended up putting on it, crazier. So when I changed the verse right before I put it out, I was mm-hmm. like, oh, this is hard. Okay. Now this is hard. So I think that's what it was. I think it was a combination of it was old and I didn't like my verse.
I see. So everybody tuning in right now.
I just figured it out.
Yeah.
Was old and I didn't like my verse.
Well, I'm glad we got an answer. Everybody check this out. Here's a clip of Best on Earth. Check this out.
I like the way she works, hey. She always puts me first, hey. And I know I've been around, but I swear you got the best on Earth. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
All right, Russ, you've accomplished so much already, man. And I watched an interview you did with Charlamagne saying that one of the last things you want to accomplish is getting a Grammy. Is that still true?
Yeah, hell yeah.
All right, and I feel like you're gonna get one of these days, bro. With the
I'm gonna definitely get one, man. At some point, they're gonna give me one.
For sure.
I got to. I've been thinking about it and manifesting it for too long.
You manifest all your success so far, so why wouldn't that happen? I feel like it's gonna happen.
Thank you.
But after you do get your Grammy, what will be your next muse or motivation? What's next after that? Just the grind. I feel like you just love to work.
Yeah, I mean, I tell people all the time, like, you know, at this point, aside from the Grammy, the only thing left to do is do everything again.
Hey.
You know what I'm saying? Which is like, that's why you can't play for points, though. Like, a Grammy is a point. You know what I'm saying? Like, platinum albums are points. I just love to make music. So, like, after I'm done getting all the rewards and trophies, I'm still just going to be sitting here like, I love to make music. So,
yeah,
I'm glad that was like, it wasn't something I was concerned about, but I'm glad that when I got money and when I got platinum albums and whatever I was still like, all right, but I'm trying to go in the studio right now, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I'm looking forward to winning a Grammy just so I can be like, all right, I've officially done everything. That's really the last thing on my bucket list. I did everything else. I went platinum on my debut. I sold out Staples Center. I bought my mom a beach house. I bought my sister a Range Rover.
Hey.
I mean, I did, like, those were all the things when I was like 20 that were on my bucket list. So
crazy.
Yeah, I mean,
you're gonna get it, bro. I know it.
The list, I'm trying to think. I did everything. So out of the ends.
You did,
after,
man.
The Grammy, I'm like, I need a new bucket list after the Grammy.
All right, now let's move on to those random fan questions. We got one from Ashley. Have you ever dated a Filipino girl? And if you haven't, you should. That's what Ashley's saying right now.
What clarifies dating?
Well, that's on you. What is your clarification? Like, you gotta. So no, the answer is no. But you've hung out.
I've never been in a relationship with a Filipina girl. No.
All right. Well, her comeback to that is,
but if they are beautiful.
They are beautiful, and if you do, you're gonna be. You have to prepare yourself for lots of food and karaoke. That's what she's saying.
Beautiful.
Beautiful. All right, Gina M. Who was the first artist you heard that gave you that spark to start rapping and singing?
Eminem.
Ooh. Love that. Okay. You only have a choice of three artist catalogs to listen to for the rest of your life. Who would they be? The three artist catalogs. That's a tough one, actually. It's really tough.
Drake, Kanye, Nipsey.
Nice. All right. If you could time travel, would you go forward or backwards?
Ooh. Backwards.
But would you do anything, or you just want to observe?
I would move around some things.
I would too.
Yeah, going forwards is whack, because then you come back and there's nothing to even live for. You already know what's gonna happen.
Very true. Very true.
You might as well go backwards and like make shit absolutely perfect. Yeah, if you had to pick one.
Yeah. Susie's asking, do you have any weird phobias or fears?
Yeah, I don't like. I'm sketched out about my collarbone since I was like two. I don't like. I don't think anyone's known that. Nobody knows that. I've never said that, but no one's asked the question. I would have answered that, but if somebody asked, like, oh my god, bro, what?
Okay, all right.
You'd never get a tattoo that would pass out. I would die.
Oh,
it's,
man,
like a torture chamber.
That's crazy. All right. Well, this next part is: Have you ever used a burner account?
A burner account? Oh, yeah. Like Twitter and Instagram?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Have you ever dropped your phone in the toilet?
No.
Have you ever been catfished?
Yes.
What? All right. Have you ever
fucking 90 times? You know how many girls pop up and you're like, huh?
That's you? Okay. Okay. We know that your songs are from you, like your experiences, but have you ever written a song from the perspective of like a friend or a family member? Something happened to them and then you wrote about it through their eyes?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Have you ever broken... this is funny. Have you ever broken or ruined something by accident at like a friend's house, somebody's house, and you left it not telling them anything?
No. The first half of that, yes. The second half, no.
Oh, man, I have. I just walked away. Oops, my bad. All right, back to the music now before you go. You just released Take You Back. Amazing song, bro, with Kaylani. Thank you. It's number 5 on our countdown right now. And
let's
of course,
go.
I think it's going to climb after this interview.
Yeah.
How long did it take to conceptualize that and actually have it finally be released? Was it a long process?
Nah, that was just, man, that's just, that was just another night for me down here in the basement in the studio. And I've been trying to make a song with Kaylani for years, like 5 years. So I've been sending her stuff. We've been like, you know, maintained a professional relationship, just texting songs back and forth, whatever. But, or not her texting me songs, me just constantly trying to get her on songs.
Yeah.
So I sent her this one and I was like, yo, this is the one. And she was like, wow, I really like this. And she sent it back super fast, like 30 minutes. So
that was.
And I knew once I heard her verse, I was like, out of here.
Once I even just heard you talk about it, like, yo, you're going to be on a song with Kaylani, I was excited. And we all were, because the Philippines love you and they love Kaylani hard, bro. It's crazy how your two fan bases here.
That's dope. Amazing. She's fucking amazing.
She is. She was out here last year, too, for a show. And
It was nuts.
And like I said, Russ and Kaylani on the track. What? Come on. Yeah. Get out of here, man. Get out of here. And last time you were here, you were saying that you were impressed by the covers you see of your songs, and I see some for Take You Back.
Where have they been at? I want to see some.
You haven't seen any? I've seen some.
I've been off Twitter for like 4 days, so maybe I'm missing out.
I've seen mostly like IG stories and stuff like that. The Philippines is a very musical country, bro.
Oh, I saw the kid do the guitar
with the camera inside, I think.
He's nuts. I don't even know how they filmed that. Yeah, exactly.
There was one like that. Oh, the one you're talking about is electrical guitar, I think.
No. It's what you're talking about. The acoustic guitar with the cameras like on the inside. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Insane.
So much talent all around the world. But Philippines, bro, I know you're going to get a wave of covers from your Filipino fans.
Can't wait. They always do them so much better than the song.
You said that last year, too, when I talked to you.
I know. I'm like, fuck. You know how many times I've been on stage, bro, singing fans' covers on accident, like in my head?
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Bro, what? Like, there's this one girl's cover of Ain't Nobody Taking My Baby there's like two of them that are so good that every time I'm on stage singing Ain't Nobody Taking My Baby, I always want to sing their cover.
Their version.
Yeah, it's fucked.
Let's check out this clip real quick of a cover of Take You Back.
Amazing.
Take you back, who am I? If I can't take the heat, take you back, let's be real, cause you've taken back me. This is hard, I love you, we fuck up, this is life. Take me back, I'll take you back, yeah. Take you back. Why should I take you back, man? You don't wanna fuck this up, yeah. You don't wanna turn this out. And I know that you're young, rich, and you put me to love a bitch. Move, kissing it.
All right. So the video, what were the challenges during this, you know, pandemic of shooting it? Anything out of the ordinary or nothing much?
No. I guess I've just been lucky. I haven't really felt the pandemic at all.
Is it just your area? Because how is it in your area? Is it like, I guess, plateauing in terms of cases and things like that?
I don't know. I think the CDC doesn't know what the fuck is going on. You know what I'm saying? One minute it's this, next minute, actually, never mind. No, it's like, all right, I'm not, whatever. Like,
man, I'm so excited to see it. And everyone that's watching.
The video is crazy. It's coming. It's just, man, it's been a process.
And after this, I know you're always dropping music anyway. Any hints on what's next? Like, is anything else coming? Like, maybe
some shit that nobody expects.
Man, you know what? I'm not going to, because I asked you this question last year, so I'm not going to ask you again. But I have some artists in mind right now that I wish you would work with, and I'm hoping it happens because, you know, you have a unique voice. And then whenever you blend with the right person, it just sounds amazing. Just like this Kaylani track, this Take You Back track. This is like a perfect song. And I don't mean to kiss your ass all year. Thank you. Bro.
I'm glad you like it because me personally, bro, I think it's one of my, I mean, just from like a sonic standpoint and really just from a, like a feeling, like it's one of my favorite songs ever, like for sure. Like it's easily the best one I've dropped in this little like flood, but it just, I don't know. it feels special, especially when Kehlani comes in and does the harmonies and shit. I'm like, man, they're just, yeah. So I'm glad, like, when people like what I like, it feels good as far as my songs.
There you go. Well, one last message to all your fans out here in the Philippines and those watching around the globe right now, man.
Y'all are some of the best fans in the world. And it's funny, me and Illmind were talking about going out to the Philippines before the pandemic. We were talking about going out to the Philippines and just setting up shop and fucking with a bunch of Filipino artists. And
oh, man.
Yeah.
Don't tease us like that, bro.
I know. But then the pandemic hit. But it's, yeah, one of these days we'll probably do that.
What's great is
go out there and make a whole project or something.
What's great is you have the Philippines in mind. So that alone makes us really, really happy. I'm so glad you're here.
Mahal Kita to all my Filipino fans.
Thank you so much, Russ, for your time. We appreciate you. We're going to really support you, whatever you do, man.
Thank you, man.
And everyone watching right now, you know what to do. Stream Russ's new track, Take You Back with Kehlani. Watch the video, share it with all your friends, and vote, because it's at number five right now.
And we're up against like K-pop people, which is insanely difficult to...
That's a great thing. You're on the countdown with those crazy fan bases, man. They're crazy. Yeah. I don't even think they hear the song sometimes. They just vote anyway. No, anyway, they're just, whatever.
I need some of those fans.
Maybe you got to work with someone like that one day.
I know. Maybe. I know. All right.
Russ, thank you so much, brother.
Thank you, man.
All right. God bless. Peace, man.